Let's today, 40-minute sessions, each session 30 minutes, with 10-minute questions for you guys. And let's hand over to our first speaker.
Okay, so since we have 40 minutes between each for each slot, and there's no break between them, so we'll give you a heads up 10 minutes before the end of the speak. Okay, last 5 minutes for Q&A. At that time, the next speaker needs to arrange himself for his next slot. Thank you very much.
Can you hear me? No? What if I move this all the way up here? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Is it getting better? Okay. So, good morning. It's good to be here. My name is Vangelis Koukis. I work for GRNET. I'm the technical lead for the Cinefo project. I'm here to talk to you about how to combine Cinefo, Data Analytics, Data Tabella, and Glassel to provide unified storage for cloud resources. Now, Cinefo is our cloud platform. We built it based on Garnetti. Garnetti is the best tool for virtualization management out there. We should see the talk that Mito has tomorrow morning, same slot. Tabella is our platform storage layer that uses multiple storage backends, and we use Ceph to provide a storage backend for Tabella. This is what I'm going to talk about. Now, I'd really like to base most of the presentation in a live demonstration, but I can't do it right now because the network is way too slow. It's got way too much latency. So if you could just, you know, just for once that you can also listen to me, turn off your wireless, and we could try using the service. And if it doesn't work, then we're going to have to describe and imagine what's going to happen. But certainly better we can actually see taking place, right? Okay, so where did it all start? Cinefo was built initially to power GRNET's public cloud service. We call it Okeanos. It's Greek for ocean, because it's a good name for a, you know, vast cloud service. Okay. Design started late 2010. We're in production since July 2011. We have been running our installation ever since. It's a single deployment. We've migrated it from version to version. We still have VMs that have been created from this time. I mean, we didn't have a downtime. The whole data center lost power, but okay, we didn't have something to do about that. We're now at more than 5,000 users. We have more than 7,000 VMs running. We installed more than 250,000 VMs and created and destroyed more than 70,000 virtual networks, which are, you know, pretty good numbers. We scale, it works. Okay, how did it work and how did we build it? We wanted to build an Amazon-like service in the sense that it provides compute, storage, and networking capabilities. We wanted the VMs to be persistent, meaning the VMs should be able to withstand transient hardware failures. How do you do that? I'll be talking about that right next. Everything we would do with the open source Cinefo is two closed BSD licenses. You can download it if you want, you can deploy it yourselves, you can go see our demo site, which I'm also using for this presentation. We wanted to create production on such a service. I'm calling that user interface that would be as simple as possible because our target group was students and researchers which didn't actually have any previous exposure to cloud infrastructure. So how can we build that? What kind of tools can we use? Why is it difficult to do? Everything would be based on commodity hardware, no storage area arrays. How do you do virtual machine migrations if you don't have any shared storage? Because we wanted the VM to be persistent and resistant to hardware failures. Contrary to most cloud approaches, we treat the VMs as our pets. People would say that pigs are cattle, that you have 1,000 cows and you let them go out in the field and they eat grass and they bring you back milk. And if a cow dies, okay, who cares? I mean, I think they have an emotional connection to it. Well, we believe this puts an enormous burden to the application writer. That he or she has you know, to manage multiple VMs and maybe create new ones when a VM fails. Most people can't actually do this right now. People will set up their VM, their file server or their main server, they will configure it the way they like. They want it to remain alive if something goes wrong. They love it, it's their pet, they take care of it. And Garnetti is very good at managing this kind of VM. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to combine Garnetti's reliability coming VMs, and CFOs offer flexibility and well-known cloud APIs. We're exposing the OpenStack APIs. We're not using OpenStack code, but we're exposing OpenStack APIs. You can speak to CNFO as if it was an OpenStack installation and use JCloud or Native Cloud. We've used these kinds of libraries. And why is this approach good? Because it's much more manageable. We can upgrade things independently. So how are we building what we're building? We're using CNFO to provide the OpenStack APIs to the outside world. We're using Ganeti to actually manage the virtual machines using multiple Ganeti clusters at the back end. So CNFO receives OpenStack commands and translates them to Ganeti commands. We're using DRVD inside Ganeti to provide reliable machines without any storage array. And we're also using Archipelago to provide enclosed and snapshots for virtual machines. We're using Archipelago to provide a unified way of handling storage, the way we've been describing right up at the time. We're using Seth as a backend to Archipelago, and we're exposing the OpenStack API. This is the overall feature. Don't try to grasp every single detail. The idea is that CNFO is all the way up on the top. It's a thin layer implemented in Python. It uses multiple Ganeti clusters for handling the VMs and it uses Ceph backends for handling the actual server. What can we do with this? And what do I demonstrate today? What do we mean by unified storage? We have a file storage service, right? Users can upload files to their file storage service. They can do it in a Dropbox-like way, in the sense that they synchronize the files with partial transfers. If I have a 10 gigabyte file, I can change like 4 megabytes in it, then I can re-upload it to my storage service and only need to upload those 4 megabytes that I have changed, right? And I can do it with files. Well, we need images, the templates for building VMs, the exact same way as files. Images are files. We don't use a different service. We don't use a different storage backend. It's the exact same backend, the exact same files, plus some custom metadata. And that's a good thing because you can re-upload your huge Windows or Debian image in seconds. Have you ever tried uploading an operating system image over a 3G connection? Let's say a 5 gigabyte image. Would it work? How long would it take? It would be more or less a disaster. Well, you can do it because if somebody else or you has previously uploaded a similar image, then you only need to re-upload what's actually meaningful for re-uploading, the change blocks, right? And then you can share files with your colleagues, right? You can share your picture from your vacations or something. You can do the exact same thing with the exact same APIs for your images as well. We use the same code because, you know, images are files. Okay, let's move a bit forward. You know, you now want to, so you've got your files on your storage service and you registered them as images. You add the required metadata. It's a Linux image, it's got this item and so on and so forth. And then you can create VMs from these images by cloning them into like disks, into volumes. And this also happens in a unified way. We do it with thin clones, the data doesn't actually move. And then after some time, the VM keeps working and keeps producing data. And then you need to snapshot it back. So you create a snapshot from a live volume into a snapshot file, which again is an image, which again is a file. So you can actually go download last day's backup in a synchronized fashion. You say, I want to snapshot back my VM once every 10 seconds, or once every anyway. And then you can go sync this snapshot back to your machine and you only need to download the change blocks. And all these things, they remain in the same Archipelago storage backend. We treat them uniformly, right? This is what I'm going to be demonstrating. If you need to ask something, please do, okay. we can make a more interactive presentation tomorrow. So, what I'm going to be doing is, first I'll switch the screens. Okay, so this is a demo installation of the latest and greatest Cinema version. It's a development snapshot. I hope it works. If you can, just please, you know, disable your Wi-Fi because it's way too slow. It's too slow. Certain things just don't seem to work. I could try to. Okay, let's try. If it doesn't work, then we abort and we just describe things. It doesn't work. Later on, when things have subsided, I think in the network, we can even do a demonstration one-to-one. Why are we using Garnet? Garnet is a tool for managing virtual machines. You give it commands, please create this machine for me, and it executes them on multiple nodes. These nodes are called a cluster. Garnet has multiple drivers for handling storage. We have actually contributed some of these drivers. We are one of the biggest external Garnet contributors. All these methods, all these external storage ways of drivers for handling storage, we can use them on Cinema. And we expose them all the way to the user. The user can pick on which kind of storage backend, his or her VM, will run, depending on the intended usage. The user can pick, I want a DRBD-based VM, or to not synchronize the data for migrations, or I want an Archipelago, an RBD-based VM. And we use Garnet only in Node API, just in few commands. So this is the overall feature. The user comes from a command line client or from the web interface. They use the standard OpenStack API, the OpenStack Node API, for example. and we convert commands to individual direct classes. We have an integrated identity service before we start calls, we for logs. It was a nice thing, to take care of boundaries. It can support multi-certification methods, Google-based plugins, LinkedIn-based plugins, Google-based plugins, classic email passwords. We have it integrated with our shibboleth infrastructure. We also provide services to our home European community IT game. If you have an academic account in a European university, you can actually go use our production service with your own credentials. We do quotas. Our compute service is a thin layer in Python and Django that only needs the internet the OpenStack APIs without actually doing the hard work. It passes the hard work on to the meeting. Networking is pluggable via Kubernetes side scripts. We can do multiple methods of isolating virtual networks, either using distinct VLANs, which does not scale greatly if you're on the 5,000 user state. We can do MAC address-based filtering on a single VLAN to provide the illusion of multiple virtual networks. We can do VXLAN encapsulation. All these we provide in a sample script. Or you can run your own if you want to. External So that's the overall picture, the identity service in the middle, the compute service, and the service, all speak to you. How do we interact with Kubernetes? An external command comes, we ask Kubernetes to actually make it happen. This is the effect part. Something happens in a Kubernetes cluster, we learn about it, and we update user visible state. Why is that good? Because the administrator always has a side path to the Kubernetes clusters. So even if CNFO goes down, or even if you're upgrading it, or even if it's not the most stable code on earth, because you know this does happen, something breaks, your VMs are still there, they're still managed by Kubernetes, you can still go and migrate them if something happens. And then your control path comes back up, and then your users can have access to the VMs to control them. But the VMs were never down. And we're actually doing this right now in production. We've done numerous rolling upgrades and kernel reboots, and nobody ever knew a thing. We migrated VMs from node to node using the enabling commands, and nobody understood a thing. Now, let's go to the unified storage part. Our storage service exposes the Swift API to the outside world, plus extensions for efficient synchronization. What are these extensions? Every file gets chunked up in blocks of individual 4 megabyte blocks. When I want to upload a file, I ask the server, I want to upload that file with these specific blocks, I hash them individually. These are content addressable blocks. I ask the server, I want to upload these specific blocks. If you have them already, the server replies with missing blocks. So I only need to upload these. When I want to download that file, I ask the server, what's the list of names for the blocks that comprise this file that I want to download? I compare it to the blocks that I already have, and I only need to download the missing blocks. Does this make sense? Why is this important? Because if your images are huge files, you can do partial uploads and downloads, and be much more efficient. All of this is backed by Archipelago. Archipelago is our common storage backend for files, images, snapshots, and volumes. And Archipelago is backed by itself. So what is Archipelago? On one hand, we have resources. Resources are files, images, volumes, and snapshots. All of these things are handled as maps to individual blocks. Blocks are stored on a storage backend, on SEV. We we decouple the snapshotting and the cloning logic from the individual physical storage. Let me move on and show you. These are files, my Dropbox files. These are images, files on which I have provided capital. These are volumes, live VMs. These are snapshots. I have my image. I clone it into a running VM. My running VM, I'm going to use it into a snapshot. How does this happen? I've got the snapshot about this. I clone it into a live disk. How do I do that? All of these things are handled as maps to individual blocks, and the blocks are stored on individual backends. And the archipelago is in the middle, handling this kind of mapping. I've got my golden Debian image. I want to spawn 100 virtual machines from it. Fast. How do I do it? I do not copy the individual blocks to create 100 individual disks. I just copy the mapping and refer to the original blocks. These are my two VMs. They each have 3 and 2 disks. These are just linear block ranges. How do I go from commands on the disks to my actual storage? On the left-hand side, the VM says, I want to write to block 5, I want to read from block 6. On the right-hand side, I speak to my storage bucket, which is set, Rappos. And I say, write this block, read this block. How do we bridge these two worlds? How do we translate from VMs to write individual block numbers to actual storage or name documents? In the middle is the archipelago core. It knows the map behind every resource. The volume composer will receive the top request, translate it, and give it to the backend. We have northbound drivers. For example, we expose this volume as a Linux block device. This is a kernel driver. Or we could expose it as a file for people to download. Or we could expose it as a user space drive for Kenya. We receive this command and then we use southbound drivers to speak to a set bucket to bring it up. Initial implementations for based on NFS are southbound drivers to drive and bring it from NFS files. The upper layers didn't know anything about it. So we were able to do deep clones and snapshots over NFS. When we want to leave NFS, we migrate all the named blocks, driving 6-3, from NFS files to Rados objects, and nobody else to do it. Archipelago has mapping drivers. We're experimenting at the point of application. Rados driver for set, and a file driver for NFS. This is the southbound interface. The northbound interface, we've got a kernel block driver for exposing block devices to kernel, a kernel driver for exposing user space drivers, and an HTTP gateway, which actually makes the files appear, the volumes appear as files over switch. And this is how the actual mapping happens. This is a read-only map for a snapshot. We clone the snapshot into a read-write map. We just have to copy the map. Whenever a write operation happens, we copy the blocks so that we can do copy and write. And we write on the copy of the block. Then we can snapshot the volume back into a read-only map. And this happens for everything. This happens for files, for images, for snapshots, for volumes. This is the overall picture of running the archipelago on your infrastructure. VMs. To the kernel block driver, it translates to archipelago to commands to the individual storage service. Or users can speak to our web server, speak to our HTTP gateway, and use archipelago to access their snapshots and the images of the world. I won't be speaking about this because I'd like to make some time for questions. Why is it a good thing? Why does it work? We can do independent Ganesi and CNF upgrades without the user noticing. We can do CNF bug fixes without the VMs going down. We do not have a single database holding all VM information. Some information is held inside the Ganesi clusters, the live VM information, migration statements, and so on. And the cloud stuff is held in our own database. The cloud nodes, the Ganesi nodes, they do not have access to our own database. It's a more distinct way of seeing things. We have been able to do node evacuations in production, live migrations. We're able to do across data center from Linux to AMD machines. Nobody understood a thing. We're able to do migration from NFS to routers. Nobody understood that their blocks were moving. We have scaled from a few physical hosts to, in the order of hundreds of hosts, now about 300 hosts. We're able to add Ganesi clusters dynamically for image scaling and expose or hold choice regarding the storage backends to the user. This is our website. You can go download the software. You can go experiment with our demo installation. I really want to give it a try and I don't know, show you the demo side at least. But it doesn't seem I'll be able to do it anytime soon. Thanks for your attention. Would you like to ask things, talk about things? Yes.
Hi, I'm Luis Deschai, I'm a SAP developer, and the feature phrase of SAP has been delayed 2 weeks. So would you like something to make your life easier?
Yeah, we'd like scrubbing to have less impact on production systems. Because we are running SAP in production right now. And it's working beautifully. But when they start scrubbing or deep scrubbing things, the OSDs go, you know, they are almost inaccessible. So we had users complain that their IO operations didn't complete. And had to stop scrubbing with the guide to make things come back to normal. It's in the order of tens of nodes, about 20 physical nodes. It's in the order of a few petabytes, 1 or 2 petabytes. We have had issues with latency. Rather suppose it's quite some latency. If you're doing network-based I/O, we have latency at the shows and the VMs. So we cache as much as we can near the clients. We have a caching version of Archipelago, which caches on the clients. And only does the actual I/O. The VM says, I want to sync this back to this. I want to hit this, the magnetic plate to this.
How far are you?
We're over 10 G Ethernet, it was the same data center. Yeah, but if you're doing 4K writes with 1 or 2 outstanding requests, within, no, half or 1 millisecond latency shows. Yes,
How large are
our Ganesi clusters? We're trying to keep them pretty small because they're much more efficient and responsive this way. We're trying to keep them in the order of 15 nodes. We don't have to do it, but they're pretty loaded right now. And since we're exposing a cloud service, we do have a very high request rate to Ganesi clusters. So we're keeping them at about 15 or at most 20 nodes. So the question is, if we're cloning a golden image to a VM, do we still use the RDD? No. If the user selects the RDD, I could actually demonstrate it. So please go and see when the network is out of operation. So, not guaranteed, but we could do it. So here's the thing. I'll repeat the question for everybody here. You're saying, if one, two, three clones of a golden image, can we do it with the RBD? No. you select their keys as your storage, you'll experience a 5 or 10 minute delay until the image is copied from our blocks to the RBD. That's what we're doing exactly, we're detaining the image. But if you use archipelago-based storage, we know they're backed by the same buckets, we'll just say, let's clone this into 100 folders. What's the question again?
You still do small amount at the end, still use the images back and it takes 5 to 100.
Well, doesn't, yeah, but this would take 5 images by 100. But this would take 500 things, right? And then your networking would be the bottleneck because you know what you have to do. And you don't really want to do it for short lived 1 or 2 week VMs, for example. If the user wants his VM to survive for a year, a main server, then he will create a new RBD. Otherwise, we're giving the option to the user.
So, do you have to always cut like the quota in order to
yes.
I also buy the user? So, and some guy can use it and start that line over 100 nodes so that all your cluster breaks down.
We have cloud level quotas in the sense that every resource is accounted for. We have a nice dashboard which feeds. Oh, of course, let's see. Okay. Let's, please, no, phone is ready. Let's see. Okay. These are dashboard. These are storage space on Pythos. I've given myself humongous amounts of product. These are system disks, number of CPUs, amount of the RAM, number of virtual machines, number of virtual networks, and number of basically these that the user has allocated. So we limit the number of VMs, for example, that the user can create. We don't actually do IO-based limitations right now, but we do plan to do this. Follow flows and enforce quotas on individual flows. Let's say the total number of IOs per user, by combining his or her flows, will be this much. We don't currently do this. Yes. Sure, but how do you do that? Eventually, yes, they are accessible to our system. Okay, this is an interesting question. The question is, yes, that's what I'm going to do. If the snapshots and the images are stored on our storage system, Pythos, that's how we call it. If something comes to the data center, what happens with availability and, you know, reliability and robustness? Do they get destroyed? Well, our storage system currently, a single installation lives inside a single data center. But then you have two Pythos installations, two different regions. If you have one here and one in Athens, for example, the very fact that we account for individual blocks allows you to very efficiently synchronize your important files to a very remote region. You can say, every night, I'll be fetching maps from region A and comparing them with maps from region B. And I only need to transfer, as a user myself, right? I only need to transfer that many blocks, the ones that have changed. We could even automate this. What we are doing is Pythos exposes the maps to the API so the users can do themselves if they want. They can synchronize the files themselves. But then, since we're using backends without actually knowing what we're doing, if Seth, for example, at some point acquires the ability to do a synchronous replication sample without actually impacting performance, without actually being synchronous, then we can take advantage of it, right? Because we're agnostic to the actual storage backend that we use. But even now, we can automate at the API level. Did I actually get to repeat attention? I think I did that. Okay. Statistics over the API. We provide, the question is, if you have a network, if you have a traffic spike, can you automate the process of bringing up new VMs? We provide statistics over the APIs. We can say, I want CPU or network statistics for my VMs. We provide the ability to thinly create VMs over snapshots. The infrastructure currently does not provide an automated way of looking at the statistics and deciding who's calling VMs. But you can do it your own if you want. If you feel that you know a certain set of VMs may come under great load, you can make requests about their loads and automatically spawn new VMs. But we don't have infrastructure that doesn't go up. The metrics are hypervisor metrics. If you look at the Linux kernel, we provide CPU and network bandwidth for every VM. Yes? Please go to the demo site and see how it works. I mean, or if you want, we can steal some minutes. Okay. Other questions? We can continue.